Micro Lecture 13, Xin China. At the beginning of the early modern period, China was dominated by the Ming Dynasty. The Ming ruled the country between 1368 and 1644. During the years that the Ming controlled the country, the population doubled, trade networks were expanded, cultural ties were established with the West, a formal bureaucracy was created based on an examination system that allowed social mobilization, the Mongols were expelled from the country, the Great Wall of China was restored, and things like literature, drama, ceramics became world known. At this time, an account of the country was written by Matteo Ricci, a Christian missionary who learned Chinese and translated classic Chinese books into Latin. Ricci also wrote detailed descriptions of the country and the people's customs. In 1590, the Ming government began to experience fiscal, military, and political problems. The country went bankrupt after confronting the Japanese in Korea and was hit by floods, droughts, locusts, and epidemics. During the early 17th century, the Little Ice Age, the country suffered prolonged famines due to shortened growing seasons and reduced harvest. Additionally, the flux of silver import from the Americas stopped, and there was widespread deflation. The crisis led to the creation of a small paramilitary groups in the countryside. The militia's members began to confront the emperor's army, and riots erupted among urban workers and farmers. In 1644, the last Ming emperor took his own life when rebels entered Beijing and a new dynasty began. The next dynasty, the Qing, ruled the country from 1644 to 1911. It was founded by the Manchus, a non-Chinese people who were descended from the Jurchens. The Jurchens were an ethnic group from the northeast. During the Ming period, the Manchus lived in Manchuria's dispersed communities, the northeast of modern-day China. In their territories, the Manchus lived in close contact with Mongols, Koreans, and Chinese. The Manchus were excellent warriors and had a strongly hierarchical social structure, with elites, middle classes, and slaves. As it was common in the Eurasian steppe at the time, several Manchu villages struggled over resources and power. The tribal affiliations and conflicts within the Manchus ended after the rise of Nurhaci, 1559-1626. Nurhaci was a strong ruler who united the people and expanded their territories. Nurhaci created a new social structure, reorganized the army, and contributed to making a shared sense of identity. He has been often compared to Genghis Khan. The Manchus first entered China invited by the Ming general Wu Sangui, who was stationed in eastern China when he heard that the rebels and the militias had captured Beijing. In that context, the Manchus saw a perfect opportunity and proposed to Wu that they join forces to liberate Beijing. Wu accepted the Manchus proposition and opened the gates of the Great Wall. Only a few weeks later, they could retake Beijing's control. When the Manchus made clear that they intend to conquer the rest of the country and take the throne themselves, Wu and many other Chinese generals joined forces with them. A short time after, the country was under the Manchus control. In the summer of 1645, the Manchus ordered all Chinese men to shave the front of their heads and braid the rest in the Manchu fashion. When their order was resisted, the Manchus responded with repression and putting in place institutions that gave China a break from war and disorder. Some of the Ming dynasty's most essential institutions, like the examination system, were adopted, and the Qing dynasty formally began. Between 1700 and 1800, the Chinese population went from 150 million to 300 million. There was more food because climatological conditions improved and new crops from the Americas arrived. Disease and pandemics were under control and governmental structures were much more efficient. At the time, the standard of living in China was comparable to that of Europe. In some regions, such as the lower Yangtze River, the people had as much money as the people in England and Netherlands, the two most developed countries in Europe. Life expectancy, food consumption, and the infrastructure were at similar levels. During these years, the country was ruled by only three emperors: Han Shi, 1661-1722, Shunsheng, 1722-1735, and Shanglong, 1736-1796. Both Shangqi and Shanglong are really important for Chinese history. K. Kangxi was crucial because he met the expectations of both Chinese and Manchurian elites and greatly contributed to the Qing dynasty's consolidation. He could speak, read, and write Chinese and made efforts to assure the loyalty of Chinese elites who remained Ming loyalists. Shanlong understood the importance of building a multi-ethnic empire. Thus, he learned many Chinese dialects and he addressed his subjects and envoys in their own languages. He also became a promoter of Tibetan Buddhism and Chinese Confucianism. Shanlong was famous for his work ethic. Every day he attended governmental matters and also practiced his reading, painting, and calligraphy. He was an avid practitioner of traditional Chinese filial piety. Shanlong erased any signs of anti-Manchu ideas from Chinese texts. During his reign, the country remained an enormous producer of manufactured goods and led the way in assembly line production. There were both private and public textile companies. The growth of the economy benefited the Qing state, and the treasury became so full that the Shanlong emperor could cancel taxes on several occasions. The Qing were able to build a multi-ethnic empire that was larger than any other in Chinese history until that moment. They annexed Taiwan, Tibet, and Xinjiang, consolidating territories and borders. They even signed a borders treaty with the Russians. Thanks to their superior technology with firearms, the Qing were also able to occupy Mongolia and dominate the Mongols for the first time in 2000 years. There is no doubt that the Qing was one of China's most important dynasties. At the beginning of the early modern period, their policies allowed them to remain in power until 1911, consolidating the country as a major force in Asia. This is all I have for you today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.